join us as we sing He is Exalted?
Loving God, we give you thanks for this day. We give you thanks for this opportunity to worship, for the music that comes to us, for the word that you offer us, and for the lives that you have given us to celebrate, to praise, and to enjoy you. As we come before you in worship, we recognize that we are privileged to be here, that it is an honor to enter into your presence, and that it is a true blessing that we are able to worship freely in a way that pleases and satisfies us, but most importantly, that meets your needs. So as we give you thanks and praise you for this time together, we recognize that we do so imperfectly. We come to you from a world that is broken. We come to you from a society that is desperate for you. We come to you from places in our lives that are lost, that are broken, perhaps even filled with a little bit of sin. And so we come to you humbly, seeking your mercy, your kindness, and above all, for your forgiveness. We hunger and thirst for that blessed gift Jesus gave us. We are desperately in need to be pardoned for our mistakes, for those things that we have done consciously, for those ways that we have gone wrong without being aware of it. So we seek the forgiveness that Christ alone can offer, and we seek the power of the Holy Spirit to not only sin no more, but to follow you more closely. As we do so, we recognize and we remember what a blessing it is to be here, what a blessing you are to us, and we pray that what we offer now will be a blessing to you in return. Now, Lord, we offer you the words of Jesus that he first taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And Anna does have some students this morning, after all. And I'm going to invite our chief cook, Clark, and reader, Paul Ascoff, to share the word with us.
First reading is from Genesis 43, verses 1 to 2 and 11 to 16. Now the famine was still severe in the land, so when they had eaten all the grain they had brought from Egypt, their father said to them, "Go back and buy us a little more food." Then their father Israel said to them, "If it must be, then do this. Put some of the best products of the land in your bags and take them down to the man as a gift, a little balm, a little honey, some spices and myrrh, some pistachio nuts and almonds. Take double the amount of silver with you, for you must return the silver that was put back into the mouths of your sacks. Perhaps it was a mistake. Take your brother also and go back to the man at once. And may God Almighty grant you mercy before the man, so that he will let you, your other brother, and Benjamin come back with you. As for me, if I am bereaved, I am bereaved." So the men took the gifts and doubled the amount of silver, and Benjamin also. They hurried down to Egypt and presented themselves to Joseph. When Joseph saw Benjamin with them, he said to the steward of this house, "Take these men to my house, slaughter an animal, and prepare a meal. They are to eat with me at noon."
Thank you.
Our second reading is from Genesis 43, verses 26 to 31, and Genesis 45, verses 1 to 5. When Joseph came home, they presented to him the gifts they had brought into the house, and they bowed down before him to the ground. He asked them how they were, and then he said, "How is your aged father you told me about? Is he still living?" They replied, "Your servant, our father, is still alive and well." And they bowed down, prostrating themselves before him. As he looked about and saw his brother Benjamin, his own mother's son, he asked, "Is this your youngest brother, the one you told me about?" And he said, "God be gracious to you, my son." Deeply moved at the sight of his brother, Joseph hurried out and looked for a place to weep. He went into his private room and wept there. After he'd washed his face, he came out, controlling himself, said, "Serve the food." Then Joseph could no longer control himself before all his attendants, and he cried out, "Have everyone leave my presence." So there was no one with Joseph when he made himself known to his brothers, and he wept so loudly that the Egyptians heard him, and Pharaoh's household heard about him. Joseph said to his brothers, "I am Joseph. Is my father still living?" But the brothers were not able to answer him because they were terrified at his presence. Then Joseph said to his brothers, "Come close to me." When they had done so, he said, "I am your brother Joseph, the one you sold into Egypt. And now do not be distressed and do not be angry with yourselves for selling me here, because it was to save lives that God sent me ahead of you. For 2 years now there has been famine in the land, and for the next 5 years there will be no plowing and reaping. But God sent me ahead of you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to save your lives by a great deliverance."
Thank you.
third reading is from Luke 15, verses 1 to 7. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear Jesus, but the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." Then Jesus told them this parable. Suppose one of you has 100 sheep and loses one of them. Doesn't he leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And when he finds it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulders and goes home. Then he calls his friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me, I have found my lost sheep." I tell you that in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent.
Couple of pictures just to help illustrate my point that we're going to have some fun, and we can as Presbyterians. So first one, please, Pete. This is fun for some people, rock climbing. You'll notice, however, she has a rope, so there is some safety involved. This one, there is no rope. This next one, skydiving. Why anybody would want to jump out of a perfectly good airplane is beyond me. Next one, please. Bridge. I personally don't understand bridge, but I know a lot of people like playing cards, and that's a fun thing to do. And we play, what do we play here? Euchre every once in a while. Next slide, please. That's a popular one for the summer, the traditional map. Next one. Some people have fun cooking, and then you get together with the family, and next slide, you have fun eating. Next slide, please. Crowd surfing, going to concerts. Next slide. Anybody recognize Jitterbug? Okay. So dancing is a fun thing to do. Some people just like to sit, relax, and read. And at the other extreme, we've got this activity, making music. And what else do we have, Pete? Playing in mud puddles. The adult version of playing in mud puddles. Rugby. And I think there's one more, camping. How many of you went camping this weekend? And how many of you already did? We still have some fun, right? And I think there's one more, right? And we like watching movies at our house. So there are a number of fun things that we can do, right? You can define your own fun. And this is one of those situations where I know I've missed some people's fun, but we would have been here for hours if I had displayed all the fun activities. You know, I didn't include stuff like woodworking or other things like that, so I apologize. But you understand where I'm coming from here. And the reason we're talking about fun is because we're entering the traditional season of summer where things become more casual. Students are out of school, people go on vacations. Sometimes factories shut down so that they can retool and the employees are given a couple of weeks off, and there is the opportunity with the sun and the blue skies and the warm weather, everything that we don't have today, to get out and enjoy the gifts of God out that way. But having fun is not necessarily a scriptural mandate. Having fun does not necessarily come from the Bible directly. The story that we had today about Joseph and his brothers, it's not, you see, it's hard to find fun in the Bible. People in the Bible don't just run out and have fun for no reason at all. Rather, what we find in Scripture are reasons to celebrate and to rejoice. So today's story describes the culmination of Joseph's purpose in the Bible. Poor Joseph had this dream that he would be superior to his brothers. Even though he was one of the youngest, he would rule over them. Poor Joseph got tossed into a pit by his jealous brothers. Joseph was sold into slavery. Joseph proved himself to be an interpreter of dreams, a steadfast guy, and he was promoted to the ruler of a powerful household. And due to a scandal with the homeowner's wife, poor Joseph went back to jail, and his story just seems to go downhill until the story reaches its peak and Joseph gets into the hands of Pharaoh, where with Pharaoh, Joseph rules Egypt. Joseph is so highly respected, he has leadership skills, he has strength of character, he actually runs Egypt alongside Pharaoh. And this comes to a head when Egypt enters into a terrible famine. In fact, the famine isn't just in Egypt, it's in the surrounding territories, and it impacts Joseph's brothers and family. So Joseph's brothers and family are at risk of being wiped out. The famine is threatening Joseph's brothers, his father, his mother. And this matters because Joseph's family just happens to be the family of Israel, the chosen people of God. So here we find ourselves in this moment of tension when Joseph's chosen people, God's chosen people, the one that God had said would be more fruitful, more numerous than the stars in the sky, they're about to disappear. But Joseph is in the right place. This is where Joseph is meant to be. Joseph has control over Egypt, which means he has control over the food, and because of his wisdom, Egypt has enough food to make it through the famine, but not just enough food for Egypt, but for the surrounding lands as well, which means that Joseph's family, God's chosen people, have hope. They will not be wiped out because God has put Joseph in a position to feed them, to make sure that they make it through the famine. And so in today's reading, we hear this emotional return. I mean, think about Joseph's situation. Joseph had been rejected by his brothers, thrown into a pit. They wanted to kill him, and one of them decided, well, maybe we shouldn't kill him. We can make some money if we put him in a pit and wait until slave drivers come by. So here he stands in power over these brothers who rejected him. And we find him crying on a couple of occasions with emotion. He's overwhelmed, overjoyed with this reunion. Things can finally be right between them. And he recognizes that God has put him in that position, that God has given him this honor, that the fulfillment of that dream when Joseph's brothers bowed down to him has come to fruition, and now they are reunited. Now there's reason to celebrate. God's people will continue. The famine will not end the line of Israel. There is hope. There is salvation. There is reason to rejoice. So it's not exactly a fun story, but it's an important and it's a happy story. The ending is happy. In fact, this ending, because Joseph will now fade out of the picture. So it's an ending for Joseph, but it really is the beginning of God's people, Israel. So far, the Israelites have been kind of hidden in the background. They're in the backwaters. They're off the map. But when they enter Egypt, God's promise becomes fulfilled And there in Egypt, they not only survive, but they thrive, they multiply, and they come to the attention of Egypt and to the world. This point here, where Joseph meets his brothers, provides them with the food that they need, is the landmark occasion when Israel enters the world's stage. From this point on, it's all about Israel. Israel rises in power. Israel gets the law. Israel becomes a dominant force. But if it hadn't been for Joseph, if it hadn't been for his wisdom, if it hadn't been for his character and God's blessing, the story would have ended, and Israel would have starved and gone nowhere. So there's reason to rejoice. But it's a biblical reason, right? This isn't going skydiving or windsurfing or working in your shop. It's not that kind of fun. When you look at Scripture, you realize that there are many occasions to celebrate. There's a lot of times when people are having fun. We find one occasion when King David, the most important figure in the land at the time, is dancing wildly before God. Dancing so freely that his wife is embarrassed. So there's this kind of rejoicing, right? David is celebrating a victory. And that's fun. There's reason to rejoice, to have fun with the temple celebrations. This is a time of joy. People are going to the temple and they're praising God for their forgiveness, for the crops that they've had. They're giving thanks for all of the blessings for simply being God's people. There are reasons to celebrate at the end of the harvest. A successful harvest is time for a party. There's reason to celebrate at a wedding. We're told that the wedding banquets were fairly large and big parties, and we know that there was wine because Jesus turned water into wine, and you often know that parties are occasions for fun, right? Parties are reason for fun. So there are lots of occasions for fun in Scripture. And there's one that's particularly noted by Jesus himself, and it's when somebody is returned to the fold, when somebody comes back home. Jesus talks about a sheep being lost and the shepherd going out and seeking out that sheep, and when he finds it, celebrating, rejoicing, having fun. So Scripture is serious. It's important stuff. But it's not sad and depressing. It's not heavy. There are many occasions in Scripture when people are invited to, expected to, desired to celebrate, to rejoice, to, in effect, have fun. And now, you really have to understand that our concept of fun is a late 19th and 20th century thing. Fun as we know it did not really exist before the Industrial Revolution, before people started taking real vacations, before there was time for leisure. The only people who were really having fun were the rulers, the people in power who had money, who had the ability to have everybody do their work for them. But for normal folks like you and I, fun was restricted to church, weddings, harvest, certain special occasions. So this idea that we have a fun is a gift in some ways and a curse. Because here's the thing about fun. What's one of the worst things that can happen to a person? Having nothing to do. Think of a retired person who after a lifetime of work suddenly has nothing to do. They have planned nothing. They don't have any hobbies. They aren't involved in the community. Their work really doesn't need them anymore. They have nothing to do. And when somebody retires with nothing to do, what happens? They don't last more than about a year. It's a sad but true statistic that somebody who retires without something to do often dies because they're bored, silly, and depressed. So we have to fill our time somehow, and with the increased leisure time that we have, we fill our time with all kinds of activities, right? I'm looking over in the back aisle there, and I'm reminded that photography is a fun thing to do as well. I mean, the number of things that we can do for fun is almost limitless because we have this leisure time. But for me, there's a kind of a break. When we just have fun to pass the time, I think there's an emptiness there. So we go back to Scripture and back to the reasons for having fun in Scripture. And what are they? Well, I guess there are about three. One of them is to celebrate God, going to the temple, worship, praise. Celebrating God is a reason to have fun. The second one is to celebrate an occasion, to give thanks for the harvest, to celebrate a wedding, to rejoice over a birthday or a stage in life. And the third reason is one that takes a little bit of thinking about, but it comes out of Joseph's act with his brothers. It comes out of Jesus' story of the shepherd and the sheep. And the reasons we have to rejoice there are because somebody does something for somebody else. The reason we rejoice with Joseph is because Joseph was able to save the people of Israel. The reason we rejoice with the shepherd is because the shepherd went out. Notice, remember the story says he left his other sheep. So the shepherd went out to find the sheep. It wasn't just in finding the sheep. It was the actual act. It wasn't in Joseph being able to say, I saved you. It was in the act of feeding his people. So our third reason for rejoicing, for having fun, comes in serving others. Those are the three reasons Scripture gives us for having fun: to praise God, to celebrate special occasions, and to bless others as we have been blessed. So, as we enter into this vacation period, this leisure time of summer, I do indeed invite you to have fun. In fact, I invite you to have fun at any time in life. But to keep in mind that the best ways to have fun are when you praise God, or you celebrate a stage, or when you simply do something nice for somebody else. So, my friends, are you ready to have some fun?
Yes.
Amen. Let's pray. Loving God, we come before you seeking to have fun. We seek those opportunities to praise you, to rejoice in the gifts that you have given us, to bask in your presence, to be one of those folks that you have found from amidst the lost. We give you thanks for those celebrations that come up in life, for achievements, for stages in life, for the harvest, for the reaping, for tasks accomplished after hard work. We especially give you thanks for the gifts that we have celebrated here at St. James, for Daryl, who's about to go on vacation and who is about to start a new big stage in his life, for Anna, who has served as our Sunday school teacher and is now going on to a big adventure at Thunder Bay, for all of those in the church who have served over this past season and who are now taking a break for the summer. We give you thanks as well for the many reasons we have to celebrate in our land, the good things that Canada provides, the blessings of our nation, its industry, and especially its farmers. But God, we recognize that within our nation and within our world, there are occasions to have some fear, occasions to be sad, that there are concerns that maybe even plague us, but certainly weigh us down. And we pray, God, that you help us to be the solution to these issues, that you help us find ways to be just in a society and in a world that is sometimes unjust, that you help us to feed and to clothe those who want for even the simple necessities, the basic necessities of life, that you help us to be bastions of goodness, truth, and mercy. And that as we serve, as we seek out the lost, as we try to find ways to help, that we do so not because it's a duty or a task that you have laid upon us, not because it's a heavy burden, but because it's the right thing to do and because it's a fun thing to do, to see the smile, to see the twinkling of an eye in someone else because they have received what they need, because they have found justice, because they have found peace. We pray, God, that you help us to do what is right and to have fun doing so. In Jesus' name we offer these words. Amen. Now, if you're comfortable doing so, please rise for our benediction and our final songs. May the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, and the presence of Jesus himself be with you this day and forevermore. And together we say, Amen.
Can
you
also say grace?
Oh, yes. Yes, let's say a word of grace while we're standing. Loving God, we pray for the food that we are about to eat. We pray that you bless the hands that have prepared it. And we pray that it be a blessing to us, so in return we may bless others with joy and with fun. Amen. Amen. So we're going to sing, and then you guys are going to eat. Thank you.
It's all done.
Short